You're listening to the audio production of Deadfall by Robert Liparulo, published by Thomas Nelson, and read by Henry Kramer. For Jody, this is as much your story as mine. Thank you. If you are going through hell, keep on going. Winston Churchill. A lifetime is a flash of lightning in the sky. Buddha. The most dangerous of enemies are the ones who hide in plain sight. Proverb. When you are unsure of a man's character, look at his friends. David Ryder. Chapter 1. Fiddler Falls, Saskatchewan, Canada. On the north shore of the Fond du Lac River, 30 miles from the Northwest Territories. Population, 242. The people trying to kill Roland Emery quickly closed the distance behind him.
Back off, Roland yelled at his rearview mirror, where the big front grille of their truck loomed.
This rutted half-road was as familiar to him as the ever-increasing contours of his face. He knew every bump, every bend. Every place where the tree stepped in closer to slash at your paint, or, if you really were not paying attention, kick a dent in a side panel or door. Still, the newcomers stayed on him, falling back on the turns, then roaring forward when only rough terrain stood between them. Their truck was one of those big fancy jobs, those pseudo-military monsters that ate ruts and boulders like granola. A jolting bump gave him a glimpse of his own face in the mirror. Red-rimmed eyes, bulging in fear. One of his shaking hands came off the wheel, fluttered to his face, and wiped at the oily sweat on his brow.
What do they want?
He thought.
No, no, no.
That wasn't the question. The question was why. Why did they want to kill him? Steering around each tight curve, he tried to get hold of his frenzied mind. What appeared to him, calming him, was his wife's face. Lizzie. What would happen to her if he died? Fine lady. Tough as the wolverines they trapped together. But she always said what kept her going through the cold mornings checking traps and the long days guiding hunters into the hills was knowing Roland would be there at night to stoke the fire and fix a cup of Nahapi sit-down tea, just the way she liked it. He pushed his lips together and cranked the wheel, taking the car down through a shallow stream and out the other side. He felt his panic pulling at him, trying to make him do something stupid. He squinted and forced Lizzie to fill that place in his mind, instead of the terror. He wished they had put some money aside, so the old gal wouldn't have to work so hard by herself if these guys after him got their way. Thank heaven she wasn't with him now.
Oh yes, at least there was that.
She'd risen with him at 5, as usual, but moving a little more slowly, with a little less spunk.
Just a little tired, Zol, she'd said. Ain't nothing.
But he knew her. Just a little tired for Lizzie was, I'd better go see the doc, for most people. So he had insisted on checking the traps alone. Which is what he had been doing when the big truck appeared, as bright yellow as a birthday balloon. He soon realized that the color had nothing to do with the owner's fun-loving disposition. Rather, it was ironic, or sarcastic, or one of those words that meant, you can't judge a fellow by the color of his car. Roland had been coming back from checking yet another empty trap when he'd spotted the truck. He'd left his old Subaru right on the rutted trail, since travelers in these hilly woods were nearly unheard of this time of year. The big yellow truck had been farther up, as though returning from camping. But he had seen it parked in front of Ben Mears' B&B on his way out of town. Fiddler Falls was too small for visitors to go unnoticed, let alone a group with a fancy machine like that. Sure enough, he'd seen where the vehicle's wheels had pushed down the grass and some saplings, on its way around the Subaru. The driver must have realized there was nothing to see but more trees along that route, and turned around. He had stopped 50 yards away, as though waiting for Roland. A man and a girl had appeared to be standing in the bed of the truck, but straps crossed over their shoulders and chests, so they must have been sitting in chairs. The chairs positioned them high enough to see over the cab's roof, and that was just weird. He had waved, but the strangers had not waved back. Instead, the man seated in the bed had pointed at a tree between them. The tree had exploded.
There had been the sound of thunder,
a blinding flash, a wave of hot air, and the tree had disappeared. It hadn't been blown out of the ground or knocked off its trunk. It hadn't fallen into the woods or across the path. It had just disintegrated. Needles and splinters and dirt had shot straight up, then rained down. The branches closest to the destroyed tree had ignited, burning like 1,000 tiny torches. Roland had fallen back into the brush, then staggered to his feet. The man's finger had swung slowly toward Roland. Roland had run around the car, hopped in, and reversed off the trail. He had turned the Subi toward town and punched the accelerator. The station wagon had coughed and sputtered, and he'd slapped his palm against the steering wheel and cursed himself for not giving it the tune-up it had wheezed for since summer. Now it was moving pretty good, bouncing over rocks and ruts, but it was no match for the newer, bigger truck on its tail. Every now and again, he'd catch a glimpse of the two heads bobbing furiously over the cab's roof. They would duck under branches hanging over the trail, and Roland thought the trees must have batted them a few good times. Still, they appeared to be laughing. When he squinted for a better look, he almost went off the road. Finally, he came out of the heavy woods and onto the dirt road that became Chateau-Tain away, a quarter mile up. Town, people, Constable Fuller. No way his pursuers would follow him there, not into the heart of Fiddler Falls. Small as it may be, witnesses were witnesses. Weaving from side to side, too many thoughts crowding his driving etiquette, he saw the truck plow out of the trees and grow larger in the mirror.
"Not here," he yelled out loud. "Not in town."
He flew past the B&B, where he'd seen the truck earlier. Approaching the town's main street, he braked. The car's rear tires tried to slide out from under him. He gave it more gas, bumping up onto Provincial Street's blacktop. The avenue was barren. Most of the town was only now waking up. The autumn sun was still burning off the gray haze of morning twilight.
Be there,"
he said, speeding past the community center on his left. His pursuers swung into view behind him. As he crossed Fife Street, he swerved to the left curb. The RCMP substation was dark. The closed sign Tom used to inform folks he was out and about leaned against the big front window. Tom made it a point to tell everyone that he, as constable, never really closed. They simply needed to find him somewhere else.
"Home," he thought. "I'll go to his..."
He saw Old Man Nelson sweep a plume of dust out of the general store's front door across the street. He cranked the wheel and shot to the opposite curb, but the old man had stepped back inside. Roland grabbed for the door handle, flicking his eyes to the mirror as he did. The truck had stopped at the intersection. The man in the cab was pointing at him. Everything happened at once. But for Roland, it seemed to take a lifetime. Metal ripped and tore. Glass shattered. Roland burst into flames. It wasn't that part of him caught fire and quickly spread. No. He was instantly engulfed. His arm spasmed. His fingers caught on the handle, and the door opened. He rolled out and stood, thinking what he needed to do. Thinking. His hair singed away. His flesh blistered. His blood boiled. He was blinded by agonizing pain, then by the physical destruction of his eyes. He stumbled, may have fallen. He did not know. Every nerve, head to toe, skin to marrow, cried out for relief. A thought, an image occurred to him. He was frying. He tried to scream. He flailed his arms, or thought he did. He.
Chapter 2. Tom Fuller sat at the kitchen table, a plate of pancakes and link sausages half gone in front of him. He was listening to Dylan complain about an older boy, a sixth grader who'd been taking kids' snacks and threatening to pound anyone who told.
"Aren't you afraid of getting pounded?" Laura asked, turning from the counter with a fresh pitcher of orange juice.
The question in Tom's mind was, who is this punk? Leave it to Laura to explore their son's thought process instead. Dylan shrugged.
"What's he gonna do? My mom's the teacher, and my dad's the law."
Tom laughed.
"Is that what I am?"
Dylan grinned and nodded enthusiastically. At 9, and with the encouragement of a stack of video westerns he'd received for his birthday, he was just realizing how cool it was for his dad to be the town's only cop.
"So what are you going to do about it?" Laura asked.
eliciting a perplexed expression from Dylan. Wasn't telling his parents doing something? Tom stopped the arc of his fork traveling toward his mouth, so he could give Dylan a smile and a wink. The kid was cute without resorting to puppy dog expressions. In puppy mode, he could soften the stoniest heart. Sometimes Tom felt sorry for him. Tom and Laura shared a love of knowledge and learning, wanting their child to also appreciate erudition. They tended to turn their conversations into teaching opportunities. Couple that with an outdoorsy lifestyle in a region where the weather battled the terrain to see which would wear a man down the most, and you'd end up possessing both brains and brawn. At least, that was the idea. Indeed, Dylan was philosophical beyond his years, but still very much a young boy. Tom didn't want him growing up too fast. Tom said,
"You could always kick him in the..."
From outside, a boom, as loud as an exclamation point, as brief as a period, rattled the windows. Dogs began barking. Dylan's face instantly reflected shock, worry, fear. Laura mirrored his expression and looked more like her son than ever. The OJ sloshed against the clear pitcher, settling from the shake she had involuntarily given it. "What?" she started.
"Stay here," Tom said.
He dropped the fork and pushed back from the table. He grabbed his gun belt from a hook and yanked open the rear door.
"Dad?"
"Don't worry," Tom said, forcing a smile. "I'm sure it's nothing. Just stay in the house." His eyes locked with Laura's. "Don't head to school until you hear from me."
She nodded. He pulled the door shut, jogged around the house, and saw black billowy smoke snaking into the sky from the center of town. Strapping on the gun belt, he ran up Camsell Drive. A door opened. Lars and Barb Jurgens, owners of the Elder Elk Diner, stepped onto the porch. Their eyes rose up to the smoke as their mouths dropped. Tom raised a hand.
"Lars, Barb," he called.
"What happened, Tom?"
Lars asked.
"Don't know. Stay here. I'll come tell you when I find out."
They went back inside. Tom rounded the corner onto Provincial Street. This was Fiddler Falls' main thoroughfare, though it consisted of only four short blocks of businesses, including an Elks Lodge, a combination town hall and community center, and Dr. Jeffrey's big Victorian house cum office. At the street's southern terminus was Dirty Woman Park, a half-moon swatch of grass, trees, playground equipment, and redwood picnic tables and benches. Tourists chuckled at the name, until they learned its literal meaning. Despite living right on the river, Becca Nahani was said never to have bathed. Never. Her stench and a patina of grime that covered her skin, caking in her wrinkles, had supported the rumor. When she had died in her 90s, she willed her small shack to the town. It had been so odorous and foul, the town had raised it and created the park in her honor. Beyond Dirty Woman lay the Fond du Lac River, half a mile wide where the town touched its banks. In the other direction, due north, Provincial Street passed, among other businesses, a restaurant, a boarding house, St. Bartholomew's Church, and finally, a small school that serviced 43 students, K through 12. Just beyond the school, the community's only paved street crumbled into dirt. Before long, it devolved into grassy ruts, marking the passage of hunters, fishermen, and other souls brave enough to venture into Canada's northern backcountry. It was the town's widest street, one lane north, one lane south, with room at both curbs to parallel park. Townies rarely bothered to drive, since a mile walk connected any two points in Fiddler Falls. Tom saw that Provincial was occupied now. A block and a half from where he stood, directly in front of Kelsey's general store, a car sat twisted and burning. It looked like the newscast images he'd seen of car bombings. A few people, likely everyone in the vicinity at that hour of the morning, had come out of the stores and businesses to watch from the sidewalks. Others were closer, in the street. Hurrying forward, he yelled to the people standing around it.
"Back away."
The asphalt around the rear of the car appeared to be burning with a low blue flame. He guessed that meant the gas tank had already ruptured, but he didn't want another explosion to prove him wrong and take out the closest spectators in the process. The first scent he recognized was ozone, a powerful sterilant that destroys bacteria, viruses, and odors. Lightning strikes and fast-flowing water create the chemical, which accounts for the fresh smell after thunderstorms and around waterfalls. In a drug enforcement course, Tom had learned that affluent pot users were known to use ozone generators to eliminate the smell of the drug. Ozone always reminded him of freshly laundered sheets. As Tom inhaled, the ozone gave way to the pungent odor of gasoline, burning rubber, and a putrid reek he could not identify. It stung his nostrils, drawing tears from his eyes. He coughed and yelled, "Step back." No one did. He realized that those nearest the car were not townies, but the group of six young people who'd arrived by float plane the previous day. They'd picked up the bright mustard Hummer, which had been sitting at the service station since the week before. According to Lenny Hargrove, the station's owner, the driver had been from a transportation service and had hitched a ride on an outfitter's plane back to Saskatoon. The Hummer's appearance had caused a flurry of speculation about who was coming. The group had moved into the B&B on Chateau Teen away.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.